And so, verse 20, but Joseph, after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from all their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And then the last verse I want to read is from the end of the Gospel of Matthew, where we read these verses. Then Jesus came to his disciples and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I hope you noticed the theme of the verses that were chosen this morning, because it's the theme of our message. In each of these portions of Scripture, the words were uttered by the angel or by Jesus that God is with us, that God is with you. Mary, you have found favor and God is with you. Joseph, God is with Mary and she will give birth to a son and he will be called Emmanuel, God with us. And Jesus, when he left this earth, before he ascended, told his disciples, I will be with you to the very end of the age. And so our theme this morning is going to be God is with us. Now we are living in a world where the population continues to increase, where people begin more and more congregate in communities, and so the cities are the places where people congregate, where the majority of the people find themselves. And so you go to cities and you talk to people, and they are amongst millions of people. There are people everywhere they look, everywhere they turn, there is a person somewhere. And yet, when you talk to them, they talk about the fact that they feel alone, that they have a sense of loneliness in their life, that there's an empty space, that there's a problem in their life that needs to be filled, that creates a void, a lack of joy, a sense of unhappiness. Why is it that we have this space in our life as human beings that needs to be filled? It's sort of like, you know, when you're putting something together and it doesn't fit quite right, and there's an empty space. Something has to go in that space. Something has to fill that space so it looks right. And you're not sure where the piece is that's supposed to go in that space. For us as people, sometimes our life looks like that. There's an empty space that isn't filled, and it doesn't look right. It doesn't feel right. And so spouses will say, why is there a space between my lover and I, the person that I married? Why is there a space? Children will say, why is there a space between my dad, who I don't see very often, or why is there a space between my mom and my dad, who I live with? People will say, why is there a space between the people that are in my family? Why is there a space between my friends? People that I thought were my friends, and there's a space there, it doesn't feel like friends. And so, like any of us, we try to fill that space. Because we're uncomfortable with it. It doesn't feel right, it doesn't look right. And so we need to fill it with something. But we're not sure what is needed to fill that space. The reality is that in Christmas time, in this season of joy and celebration, this season of happiness and cheer, these spaces become clearly more evident. The reality of life is that there isn't all joy. It isn't all happiness. There isn't a lot of cheer sometimes. We can use the words of Charles Dickens in his book when he said, "It was the best of times, it was the worst of times." For many, Christmas can be the best of times, it can be the worst of times. At Jesus' birth, or before Jesus' birth already, the angels came to announce and proclaim this story to Mary, to Joseph. And when they came to the shepherds, that song that we sang, the first Noel, they said, "We have come to bring good news of great joy, which will be for all the people." And the angels sang, "Glory to God on the highest, and peace on earth to all men on whom God's favor rests." Now, what does it mean when God's favor rests on us? My dog knows when my favor rests on him when I throw him a bone, a treat. He's happy. My master still loves me. I'm okay yet. Is that us? Do we find God's favor resting on us when we have some evidence that, okay, God has given me something that's a blessing? I must be okay yet. Is that the way we respond to God? No, that's not the way God wants us to respond to him. Mary, when the angel greeted Mary, the angel came to her and said, "Greetings." Greetings. What kind of greetings? The Greek word is the same word for joy, for rejoicing. The angel said, "Mary, rejoice." Rejoice. There is joy here for you. I'm coming to bring you joy. Rejoice. And then the angel says, "You are highly favored." And so when you ask yourself, what does it mean that God's favor rests upon us? It means that God's grace has been shown to us, that God has been gracious, that God has given us abundantly his blessings, blessings that we do not deserve, blessings that we are not worthy of receiving, but yet God abundantly pours out those blessings in our life. You have found favor with God. You are highly favored. And the reason you are highly favored, the reason that the way that you know that you have experienced God's grace, the way that you are going to find joy in your life is that I want to tell you, the angel said, that God is with you. God is with you, Mary. And today I'm going to tell you that, people of God, God is with you as well. Now, for Mary, it came in a special way. The angel said, you're going to have a child. You're going to have a baby, a baby boy. And his name is, you're going to give him the name Jesus, and he is going to be the Savior of the world. Now, Mary, we have to remember, was a young girl. She was a virgin. And so for her, this news would be, you would expect it to be upsetting, as it would be for any young girl in the world today. After all, how is Mary going to have a baby? It's impossible. I've done nothing to make that be able to happen in my life. Not only is it impossible, it's not something I want. I'm not ready. I don't want to have a baby yet. And in light of the culture, this is going to leave nothing but a negative impact in my life. People are going to look at me. I'm going to be an outcast. And women who are cast out, women who have no support, they are not in a good place. And so Mary, you would think, would say, no, pick someone else. But you know how we see that God's favor rests upon Mary? You know how we see that God's grace has been given to her? The words that come out of her mouth are not words you would expect. We often think that Mary was this very, God must have chosen her because she was the most special woman in the world. No. Because if you would think that, you would think that God chose you because you're the most special person in the world. And we all know that we're not. God chose Mary. And God showed his grace and his favor on her because she was able to say, may the Lord do as he said. As the Lord said, so may it be. Mary received this word from the Lord by faith. And so she believed that God would do what he said, and so may it be what the Lord said it's going to be. And then as she went on in life, and a few months later she went to visit her relative Elizabeth, who was also expecting this amazing child that was not expected. And she saw that God's words were coming to pass. The words that came out of her mouth were this beautiful song of praise, glorious praise to God for his grace, for his love. Now, how does that happen to Mary? It happens because, as the angel said, God is with you. Now, for Mary, as I said, it was a special experience because she was carrying Jesus, the Son of God, who came to earth and took on flesh. So her having Jesus as a baby was going to change her life forever. As all of you know who have had babies, it changes your life. Your life is never the same. That child becomes part of your life. But for Mary, it wasn't just the baby Jesus, it was God himself became part of her life. Now, does that mean that her life was this wonderful experience of all happy, joyful, celebratory times? No. Mary had a lot of pain in her life. Mary experienced a lot of sadness, I'm sure. I can only see Mary when she had Jesus and the shepherds came to see the baby, and the wise men came to offer gifts, and she pondered all this in her heart. What does this mean for me? What does this mean for my life? And it was shortly after that she and her husband Joseph had to flee their homeland. They had to go to Egypt because someone wanted to kill. The king wanted to kill her baby boy. Not just her baby boy, but all the baby boys that were born in Bethlehem, so that this special child that God had given her would not survive. And so she's fled to Egypt. And then later in her life, I can see Mary at the foot of the cross with her friends, the friends that are with her, Mary Magdalene and the others, and they're weeping. This child that she gave birth to, this special child is hanging on a cross and he's suffering. He's in pain. And he didn't deserve it. He did nothing wrong. And he dies. Now, they say that there's no greater pain than a mother losing their child. There's no greater earthly pain than a parent losing a child. Because it's part of us. It's not just someone we met on the street. This is someone that is part of us. Husband and wife, father and mother, the two became one, and it showed up in this child. And now this child is dead, killed on a cross. So Mary experienced pain. And so life with God is not free of pain. But the text says that God was with Mary. And the text says that he will be called Emmanuel, God with us. It's ironic, it's unique, it's a beautiful picture to see that the child that was conceived by the Holy Spirit in Mary and that she was carrying and that was growing in her womb was God coming to earth. Mary was the woman who was going to carry this baby in her womb. Mary was the woman who was going to give birth to this child. Mary was the person within whom this child was conceived, and life began as a human being for Jesus, the Son of God. But on the other side, this baby that was born is going to be the one who gives life to Mary. Mary, the one who gave life to Jesus, is going to be given life by this child that she bears, Jesus himself. How does that happen? It's because God is going to be with her. When the Bible says that God is with us, it's not just a term that talks about friends, acquaintances, people that we know, people that we're hanging out with, people that we're working with, people that we're sharing space with, and that may change from time to time. Sometimes we're working with people and those same people are not the same people that we're sitting in church with. Sometimes we're going out to dinner with people that are not the same people that we hang out with every day of the week. And so those people are with us at certain times. No, this is not just a friendship and acquaintance, because if that's the way we would associate Jesus, we could say Jesus hung out with his disciples. For 3 years, the disciples hung out with Jesus and they ate meals with him and they walked with him and they talked with him and he taught them many things. And sometimes people think Jesus in that way, that Jesus is this wonderful teacher, that if we listen to the words of Jesus and follow him, then that's all we need. So someone give me those words. He's a great teacher. Yes, he was a great teacher. But God with us, Jesus with us, is much more than that. Emmanuel means God is with us. He's with us in every part of our life. Spiritually. He gives us spiritual life. Spiritually, we wouldn't know God without Jesus. Without Jesus, we would be separated from God. We would be without God. We would be alone. But Jesus comes and says, I am the one who is going to reconcile you with the Father, and you are going to be with God, and God is going to be with you spiritually. But he's also with us physically. The Bible says that not a hair can fall from your head without your heavenly Father knowing it. God knows our physical pains. God knows, and he's experienced pain. He knows what it's like. He shares with us. And he joins with us in that pain. The Bible says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Now, our pride keeps us from doing that. In the same way that our pride keeps us from asking someone to help us when we are needing some help. We are a proud people. And we want to be able to handle things on our own. We want to be able to take matters into our own hands. But if God is with us, God says, I'm here to join with you in your pain, to join with you in your suffering. Come to me, all you are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Give me those burdens, and I will carry them with you. You don't have to do this alone. And God says, I will provide others to come around to support you and share with you in that pain. Now, the reality in the church is that we don't want people to think that we are experiencing pain. I will tell you that in every church that I've served, in every church that I've been a part of, and I've been a part of a lot of churches, in every congregation, there are people that don't want others to know that they're having surgeries. Or they don't want others to know that they are sick or that they have this illness. Why is that? Well, I kind of understand. We don't want people to look at us as if we are weak, if we are not doing well. But at the same time, if we really understand what it means that God is with us through His Spirit and through the body of Christ, we should relish the opportunity to have others to come alongside us. We should relish the fact that God says, I am with you, and I will carry that burden, that pain with you. That you don't have to carry it alone. That I'm not going to abandon you and leave you in your pain. Even if we separate ourselves and try to go our own way and try to make some space between God and I. God always remains close. Last week we saw that God was near, but today the text says that God is with us. With us. He's with us in the sense that without Him, we would not have life. He's with us in the sense that without Him, we would not have joy. He's with us in the sense that without Him, our marriages are not going to survive. He's with us in the sense that without Him, it's going to be very difficult for us to parent our children. Oh, people still have marriages. People still have children. But there is no joy. It's happiness. And happiness is fleeting. Happiness comes and goes. And so if happiness is there for a while and it goes, something has to change because I want happiness again. And so I'll try a new spouse. I'll try a new job. I'll move to a new location, and maybe then I'll be happy. But that's not joy. Joy is something that comes to us because God is with us, and joy is something that stays with us. It never goes away. We can find joy in every situation. And why is that so? It's because God is with us. Why is God with us? Why has God shown His favor upon us? Because He is gracious. Because He is loving. Now, if you have difficulty finding joy in this season, I know what it's like. There's this anticipation. There's this expectation. There's this looking forward to celebration. And we put up the lights, and we purchase the presents, and we wrap them, just thinking about what little Johnny, the look on his face when he opens that gift, and he's going to go, oh. But you know what happens? Johnny puts that gift down. He says, where's the next one? And hopefully, the gift that you bought Johnny is someone, one of the gifts that he does play with. But let me ask you, how many of you can remember the gift that you received last year? If you're like me, you really have to think hard. Because see, the joy, the happiness, the satisfaction that they bring, they don't last. They fade like the grass that withers in the sun's heat. But with Jesus, with God being with us, that joy never fades. So if you are not experiencing joy, if there's space in your life that you're saying something needs to go there, it doesn't feel right, it doesn't look right. If there's no joy in your life, if there's an empty space, the only person that can fill it is Jesus. Jesus is not a thing that you can go out and buy at Walmart because Walmart has everything. No, Jesus is not a thing. Jesus is a person. And you know as well as I do that people are unique, that people are something that requires different attitudes and treatments. And so Jesus is not just a thing that we can set on the shelf. You know, one of the things they do at Christmas now is Elf on the Shelf. Where's the Elf on the Shelf? And you have to try to find it. Let me ask you, did you put Jesus on the shelf and you don't know, you can't remember where he is? And you can't find him? If that's the case, we are in trouble. In every other religion, people are called to go to the God that they serve. They are called, required to go to him. It's only in Christianity that God comes to us. That God comes to us with his love. That God comes to us in person. And as Jesus said in the last passage of Matthew, I will be with you till the very end of the age. I will always be with you. So if you want to experience joy this Christmas, and not only this Christmas season, but every day of your life, if you want to have the joy that fills and fulfills you in all that you do, remember, God said, I am with you. Jesus came to be Emmanuel, God with us. And so he did his part. Now let's acknowledge and let's do our part and live our life with him because he is with us. And the mystery of that is that when we live our lives with him, when we give our lives as a sacrifice of praise and gratitude to him, we find mysteriously that it brings joy to us. Wait a minute, how did that happen? How did I experience that joy? I gave myself to Jesus, and he filled me with joy. I did what God wanted me to do, and he gave me joy. I considered others better than myself, and I loved my neighbor. Before I worried about their needs, before I worried about my own needs. And I experienced joy. That's the way God works. And God made it possible by sending his son, Emmanuel, God with us, so that we could live with God and be one with God. And God did that by grace. So just as the angel announced to Mary, rejoice, greetings, you are highly favored, the Lord is with you. Every day of our life, if we go to God, I don't know about you, but I try to say good morning to the people in my house in the morning. To my wife, to my children. And if you have any children like I do, some of them are like, don't talk to me. Maybe your spouse is that way. I don't know. Sometimes I'm that way. But we say good morning. So don't only say good morning to the people in your house. Say good morning to God because he is with you. Say good morning, God. Thank you for watching over me tonight. Thank you for this day. And here's what God will say to you. Rejoice. Greetings, my children, my child. My favor rests upon you. My grace is given to you today, and I will be with you. We are not alone. And suddenly, all these places in life where it looks like there's a missing piece, where there's an empty space, where things are not just right, suddenly they begin to fill in. And things look differently because God is with us. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this gift, this promise that comes to us through Jesus Christ, the one that you sent from heaven to earth to take on flesh, to become one of us. Not only to become one of us, but so that you could be with us and we could be with you. Lord, you being with us makes all the difference in our life. We acknowledge that. We have seen that. We have experienced that. Forgive us, Lord, for the times that we turn away from that. When we reject it. May we always remember that you go with us and that with you our life is different. With you our life has been changed, has been transformed. And may we live as those who have been changed, as those who have been transformed, as those who have experienced the joy of the Lord and find it to be our strength and our source of hope. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.